So it's recording now?
Yes.
Okay. All right. So I always have to pay you the progress. And you get another one after. Oh, I'll get it.
That's okay.
You get another one after class.
Yay.
Okay. Apparently, there's some sort of a STEM research symposium. So, why don't I pass these out in my, you know, submit an abstract for the win $2,000? I don't know. Okay, here are two of them.
I just submit the moon paper.
I also put on the class website a link to some other
deadlines.
To some other thing that you could apply to. I think it's a summer research thing. So summer research things can be quite good because they you learn something it's better than just, anyway, they can be good. So let me, I guess I should apologize for the last week of group theory. I think it was too technical. I somehow just kept going on a tangent and it got more and more complicated. Anyway, let me distinguish here. This is one of the important things in general relativity. A distinction between coordinates and physical points. Physical points. And people who do relativity often call points events. So in other words, it's a particular time and a particular place, and if you specify a particular time and place, presumably something happened there and that was an event. And the point is that coordinates and physical points are different. And you can have many coordinates for the same point, physical point, or say point or even. And in fact, the basic idea of general relativity is that you can, because the coordinates don't have any intrinsic meaning, it's the physical points that have meaning, you should be able to transform your coordinates in a way that doesn't screw up the actual points. I'm not saying that right, but the basic idea is that points are physical and coordinates are mental, imaginary, metaphysical, whatever. We can change our coordinates, but the point doesn't change. The points don't change. So that's the basic thing. There's also an idea about uniqueness of points. If we consider the points on a sphere, we can consider these as points on a curved surface, then we would use two coordinates, and in particular we might use an angle theta down from the North Pole, and then an angle phi from some meridian. and the British Navy got the rights somehow to have that meridian go through, I don't know, somewhere in England. Where's
Greenwich?
Greenwich, yes. Greenwich Mean Time, yes. And so, of course, one could pick any other North Pole, pick any other meridian, and then you'd have different coordinates. So you'd have coordinates, say, the feet. You have another set of coordinates, theta prime, phi prime. And a given point here, say this point here would have one set of theta phi coordinates, one pair of theta phi coordinates and one pair of theta prime, phi prime coordinates. And then you could then have, of course, another choice. Now, given a choice of North Pole and Meridian, each point has a unique theta and phi. Each point, except for two. The North Pole, of course, doesn't have a unique phi, because as you change phi from 0 to 2 pi, that point doesn't move. And same thing for the South Pole. And also, one can imagine that the surface of this curved surface of the sphere, we can imagine that that's embedded as it is. In fact, if it's a real sphere, it's embedded in three-dimensional Euclidean space. So we can think of it also that way. And then we can imagine it also, if it's a real sphere, that it's embedded in four-dimensional space-time and so forth. So you can have these different views of points. Now, if you have something more general than a sphere, but it's smooth. So in other words, I guess here I'm thinking about actually embedding the surface in some flat Euclidean space, some Rn, where n is 3, 4, 5, whatever. The idea here, then, is that as the coordinates change, the point moves smoothly in Rn. And if it's smooth, and then we call that a manifold. So a manifold is essentially a smooth surface, and the idea is also that we can have coordinates that uniquely specify any point, and if we have troubles with north poles, then we can use two sets of coordinates, and that usually is enough, or one can use even maybe a third set of coordinates. And the basic idea then is that for any point, let's use P for physical point, any point will have coordinates xi on the surface or in the manifold, and we can imagine that there are other, if we have other coordinates, then there'll be different coordinates for the same point, and the idea will be that x prime I of P will be x prime I of this P is also a point associated with a with coordinates X in a different coordinate system, and so we can think of that as X prime I of the X's. And the idea is that this is smooth. That is to say, infinitely differentiable and one-to-one. So the X prime to X is one-to-one. At least if we're in the right patch, we're avoiding North Pole, South Pole type things. All right. So the idea then is, for a physical point, you can have arbitrarily many coordinate systems. And now, I'm going to now make a couple of definitions that are all very simple, and they're really important. And from a certain point of view, there's a significant fraction of general relativity is just getting straight up few definitions. So the simplest one is a scalar. So a scalar is something that's the same in every coordinate system. Because if I could spell same. And in particular, if it varies with where it is in the manifold or on the surface, then the value of this scalar at the point X is the same in a different coordinate system. Is the same as B of X as long as X prime is the label in the new coordinate system for the same point X. In other words, B prime of X prime of P is equal to B of X of P. That's a scalar. Okay. Now, when you did calculus, you learned how coordinate differentials transform. So x prime I, how does dx prime I change if we change the xj, say? Well, this is a sum then over j of the partial of x prime I. Partial xj dxj. So I'm using upper indices to label the coordinates. And this j goes over however many coordinates we have. J is 1 to n. Now, this something that transforms like this is called contravariance. And so anything that transforms this way, in other words, if A prime I is the sum on J of partial X prime I, partial XJ, AJ. In other words, if we change from the X coordinates to the X prime coordinates, and we have N quantities AJ, such that in the prime coordinates they look like this, then this is said to be a contravariant vector. So this is a contravariant. By the way, I'm using this chalk. Is this okay, or do you want me to use the thick chalk?
That's good.
It's all right? All right, so that's a contravariant vector. And it could be that, in fact, most of our physically interesting vectors depend upon the coordinates. And so in that case, we would say that A prime I of X prime, and I'm going to put the P in explicitly, is a sum on J of partial X prime I of P, partial XJ of the same P, AJ of X of P. Normally one doesn't have the of P in it. In other words, you normally think of this as this way, X prime I, A prime I of X prime is sum of J, partial X prime I, partial XJ, AJ of X. This is a contravariant vector field. I think I forgot to say when I went over here, did I mention that this was a scaled field?
Yes.
I did? Okay. Well, a field is just something that depends upon the coordinates. And so this is a contravariant vector, this is a contravariant vector field. Okay, now how about covariant ones? Well, this is one chain rule, it's a related chain rule, namely that the derivative with respect to the prime coordinate xi is a sum on j of the derivatives with respect to the unprime coordinates times the partial derivatives of the unprime coordinates with respect to the prime coordinates. So this is very simple, but it defines a covariant vector. And you may say, well, how does that, let's go to a physical quantity. Suppose CI prime is the sum partial XJ partial X prime I CJ. Then the C's form a covariant vector. So this is the covariant vector transformation law. A covariant vector is something that transforms like a derivative. And if it depends upon the coordinates, then it's a covariant vector field. So, partial derivatives, things that transform like partial derivatives are said to be covariant. If they depend upon the coordinates, then they're covariant fields or covariant vector fields. I'm using the word vector. Scalar is something that has no index. You see, it's just a thing like temperature. Over here, we have a contravariant vector. It has one index. It runs over the dimensions of the space. And the same thing over here for covariant. For each coordinate, there's a derivative, and how the derivatives transform, the partial derivatives, how they transform, that defines covariant vector. So these are the basic definitions that define all tensors. Tensors are just things that have more indices, and the indices transform either contravariantly or covariantly. Yes.
Question. For the CTAN, is that an I or a J?
Yeah, you're pointing out something that's, I keep saying, I keep observing and then fail to act upon. I and J look very much the same at any distance, and it's really stupid that we always use I and J in equations. I try not to do it, but, so, which one?
For C prime, I guess maybe that's an A. Or
this
an
is
I.
A, well, let me get religion and do things right. Let's see if I can find a decent eraser. So let's use the right notation. If that's I, let's use a K. Oh, I screwed it up. If that's an I, this is the I. And so it's a J, it's a K. Okay, so then CI. Okay, so that's that one. And then over here, we use K. All right, so I can only write a note to myself. Use K. Yes.
Just taking it back to the special relativity, are kinetic energies in different rest frames covariance or contravariance?
Okay, all right, let's think of it.
Or,
right, yeah.
The times or the lengths?
Well, first of all, a great question. It turns out that in special relativity, the difference between covariant and contravariant is just a matter of minus signs. So in other words, you just change the sign of the time component and you go from covariant to contravariant in special relativity. This business here that I'm telling you about is the way to think more generally, and the way to think that's appropriate for general relativity. In fact, let's back up from special just down to Euclidean space, like points in this room. Okay. Here, in Euclidean space, there's no difference at all between covariant and contravariant. We should see this in a moment. As you go to special relativity, there's only a tiny difference, a sign change. And then in general relativity, well, we have this general definition, and if we're making coordinate transformations that are arbitrary, but we require that they be one-to-one and infinitely differentiable, okay, so really smooth, but apart from that, and one-to-one, but apart from that, totally arbitrary. It's those transformations that have significant partial derivatives here. In other words, these are arbitrary functions, essentially. Whereas in special relativity, they're just 4x4 matrices, and to go from covariant to contravariant is just, as I said, a minus sign in the time.
Maybe just a quick follow-up, but just back to Euclidean boring space.
Sorry, say it again?
Maybe this is a really boring question, but just the basic Galilean transform, is that just this seems like it might be a covariant here?
The transformation itself is just a change of coordinates. So the word covariant or contravariant refers to how something transforms or changes when you change your coordinates. So in other words, differences of coordinates transform one way, contravariantly. Partial derivatives transform a different way, covariantly, under an arbitrary coordinate transformation. Now, if you restrict your coordinate transformation to be as simple as a Lorentz transformation, or even simpler, to just a change in your use of basis vectors in Euclidean space, then the difference in the case of Euclidean space disappears. In the case of special relativity, it's becomes just a matter of some minus signs, a minus sign. But we're sort of getting ahead of things a little bit. Let's see, did you want, maybe you were entitled to a second, you had a follow-up there. Any other questions? Okay, so this is a covariant vector field. Okay, now, suppose we have the gradient of a scalar. So suppose B prime of X prime is B of X. This is a scalar field. Then what happens to the derivatives with respect to X prime I, say, of B prime of X prime? What's that? So here, where this is the derivative in the new coordinate system. Well, we know that B prime of X prime is just B of X. So this is partial of B of X with respect to X prime I. And then we can use this rule over here, just this rule of calculus. This is the chain rule. And so that tells us that this is a sum over K of partial of B of X, partial XK, partial XK, partial X prime I. But that means then that these guys here are transforming with coefficients that are these partial derivatives, and that's what we call a covariant vector or a covariant vector field. So this is a covariant vector field. Now, in Euclidean space, all of these definitions really collapse. So let me just make sure that I've got no stupid order. Okay, so what are we going to do? In Euclidean, so let's now go to the simplest case, which is Euclidean space. And by the way, this is just an aside. It seems to me that, at least in this country and in many other countries, we really screw up kids' education in mathematics by spending sophomore year of high school on Euclidean geometry. And, I mean, it's one thing if we were going to teach Euclidean geometry, but we use Euclid's methods. And Euclid didn't know about zero, didn't know about algebra. He had to think about everything philosophically and give these verbal arguments for whatever he was doing. And, you know, that's the hardest possible way of proving the theorems of geometry. And, instead, one could introduce co-ordinates in a plane, you know, like Descartes did 200 or 300 years ago. I'm not much good at history. Between 100 and 400 years ago. With a few concepts and so forth, we could teach plane geometry and equip the students with the idea of coordinates, the idea of vectors, and a certain amount of algebra and so forth. It would be so much to their benefit. And instead, we had this student. Okay, so Euclidean space. So what we can do is we look for three basis vectors. And I'm going to call them EI. I could call them EI with an arrow over them. They're three-dimensional vectors. Or, well, we could be in n dimensions, in which case they'd be just n-dimensional basis vectors, and then instead of three of them, we would have n basis vectors. Maybe I will put the arrow there and then do EI, because it's, I don't know, the arrow normally means three-dimensional. And because Euclidean space has this dot product as a metric, we can say, well, that EI, and I'm going to get rid of the K, EI dot EI EK is going to be just the dot product of EI with EK, and then this would be a sum on L of EI, the Elf component, EK, the Elf component, and we can make these things orthonormal. So these are orthonormal, if I could spell and print, that would be clear. Basis vectors. And we can use these basis vectors then to represent any point. We can say, well, this is a sum EI XI. Is our point. And then we can define dual vectors. And now, in Euclidean space, we don't really need the concept of dual vectors, but if we introduce the concept of dual vectors, then it'll be useful in the future. So these dual vectors are such that the inner product of the dual vector with the vector, which then be a sum over L of EI L EL K, that this is delta, and we'll call it delta IK, but since, as I said, this is Euclidean space, the fact that this index is raised doesn't really mean anything. In other words, these dual vectors, inasmuch as we already have that EI dot EK is delta IK, the dual vectors are just the same as the upper vectors, and whether we raise or lower an index doesn't make any difference in Euclidean space.
Is there a reason?
So I'm introducing a notation that we'll use in the future, but it doesn't matter here. Yeah?
Is there a reason that one index is raised and one lowered for the dual vector?
Well, if we start out with basis vectors labeled by a lower index, the dual vectors conventionally are labeled by an upper index. And the idea is that we have some inner product in the space. In this case, it's just Euclidean space, so it's a dot product. And the dot product of the Euclidean, of the dual vector with the vector is just the Kronecker delta, and of course delta IK is 1 if I is K, so this is the same thing as delta IK. So in Euclidean space, raising and lower indices is totally unnecessary.
And that's why people don't do it in elementary courses.
What's the purpose of dual vectors?
What?
What's the purpose of dual vectors?
Well, in general, it's a useful thing to have. In other words, okay, great question. You do get a candy question. I think I've got to maybe hand out the candies instead of throwing them. So, suppose we're in a more general space. We might say that the basis vectors have some inner product that might be, say, Gij. Well, what about the dual vectors? Well, the dual vectors we would want, first of all, I'm going to stop using I and J. So what about K? Well, we would want EK, the dual vector, the inner product of the dual vector with the vector should be delta K I, which is to say 1 or 0. So that's the idea. Okay, so where were we here? So once we introduce these dual vectors, you see, we can say that these coordinates, xi, are just the inner product of the dual vector ei with the point p. Because that would be a sum on, let us say, k of ei with e lower k xk, and this would be delta ik xk, and that, of course, is this ei. So in other words, if we want to know the coordinate, we can use the dual vector to find the coordinates of the point P in the coordinate system that has these as dual vectors, or that has these as basis vectors. Okay, so we have then that xi is just the inner product of the dual vector with p. And of course, this inner product is nothing more than the dot product because we're in Euclidean space. That inner product that I was talking about is just a dot product. If we use different orthonormal vectors, then we would say p was a sum ei prime. And then it would be x prime I. And what would we say about the x prime I? Well, x prime I then would be e I or e prime I dotted into p or in a product with p. And this would be a sum e prime I, and then this would be e prime k x prime k, and as you see, this would eventually give us x prime I, because this is product of delta, this would be delta. And we'd have the companion relation, namely that xj would be ej. Well, let's say k. Ek dotted into p. And if we wrote p in terms of these ones, then it would be the sum on I of ek dotted into ei prime x prime I. And this then would be sum on I delta k I x prime I, and that would be x prime k
So we have these two relations to go from. We go from Oh, I screwed up completely here. This was stupid. I'm supposed to follow the notes, and when I don't follow the notes, I sometimes screw. Where's the eraser?
There's one in the sink.
Oh, here it is. It's on the table. So what I wrote down here was correct, but kind of trivial. The whole point here, what I meant to say, was let, if we have the, is let P be PK XK. So that tells us that the X prime I's are the, related to the XK's by the inner products of one set of dual vectors with the other set of basis vectors. Similarly, over here, what I was, let's see, did I do it right there? Yeah, I happen to have done it right here, but then this is a mistake. I wish I could say that I've been drinking, but I'm stone cold sober, so. In any event, what you see is it's these inner products of dual vectors with basis vectors give you the transformation from one set of coordinates to the other. This is very simple in Euclidean space. It's more complicated. Other relations hold more generally. Okay, now, in fact, these X's that, these E's that I've been talking about in Euclidean space, they're, I've kind of been speaking as if we had just one set of EIs or if we change to a different set of basis vectors, then we have an EI primes, a different set. But we could, everything that I said so far would also apply if these basis vectors depended upon the space time, the space or the space time point. In fact, if we're just doing Euclidean space, I guess it should be the space. In other words, these could be EI of X, because we haven't differentiated anything, so we haven't, so what we've said so far isn't sensitive to the issue of whether or not the X's are the same, the vectors are the same everywhere in Euclidean space. And you're all actually familiar with cases where the basis vectors do depend upon the position in Euclidean space. For example, in spherical coordinates, you might have basis vectors r hat, theta hat, and phi hat. And so these guys, in other words, we can call them e sub r, e sub theta, e sub phi, and in three-dimensional Euclidean space then, what you would have is if you have some point here, which is, say, an angle theta there, and this line is an angle phi there, and this distance is a distance r, and this is the point, then er is a unit vector that way, e theta is a unit vector this way, and e phi is a unit vector that's basically the cross product of ER with e theta. And in cylindrical coordinates, it's a little bit simpler. It's that you have a point here that has a certain z value and a certain angle here, phi. And so you have a vector rho hat, or e sub rho, that points out along this vector let's see, phi is a vector that points this way, so I'm trying to get my, this thing, what's the right-handed way, is it rho phi z? Rho is pointing forward. Yeah,
rho phi z,
yes, yes. In other words, if I, see, I didn't draw this. So, phi is e sub phi, e sub rho goes like that. E sub phi is sort of like that. And so, e rho crossed into e phi gives you e z, which is, of course, pointing up. So, so if we allow this, then these are called orthogonal coordinates. On the other hand, if we say, well, our vectors here are independent of space, and we just pick, say, x, y, and z. In other words, I, j, k, you often call them, and then they're the same at every point in space, in Euclidean space. We do that, then the e's are independent of where we are in space. And in this case, if we look back at these relations, xk is given by this, x prime I is given by that, then what we would say is that the partial of x prime I with respect to x, let me use J because I don't want to have to do this on the fly. This, well, actually we do have K, sorry, let's just do that. So the partial of X prime I with respect to XK would be E prime I dot EK. And that is the sum e prime I, say, L, the lth component of K, summed over L. And we could I'm trying to figure out what I well, let me just go over here. Partial xj, xk, with respect to x prime I is ek dot e prime I. And since we've said that the upper and lower indices don't matter, this thing is the same as that. And consequently, this is the definition of, let me get it straight. This is the definition of contravariant, and this is the definition of covariant. So covariant and contravariant are the same in Euclidean space. There's a counterexample maybe worth looking at. Namely, suppose we can use in two space, we can use x, y, or polar coordinates. And now we would have partial r, partial x is actually x over r. And this is the same as partial x, partial r. And we'd also have partial r, partial y is y over r. And that's the same thing as partial y, partial r. On the other hand, the theta derivatives don't work. In other words, we don't have partial theta, partial x. Partial theta, partial x is minus y over r squared, and that's not the same thing as partial x, partial theta, which is minus y, actually. And also, partial theta, partial y is x over r squared, which isn't the same as partial y, partial theta, which is x. So the idea here is that the polar coordinates are not Euclidean, and also they have different dimensions. This is a length. These three are lengths, whereas that's an angle. And so, in other words, these simple relations that occur for Euclidean coordinates don't occur in general if we switch from Euclidean coordinates to polar coordinates. All right, now,
can you transform between two different dimensions, like between Can you transform between two different dimensions, like between two space and three space?
Let me think about that. Why don't I get you a candy? I'm afraid to let you touch me because you're sick. On the other hand, you may be sick with my cold from a week or two ago. Okay, so you were saying going from one set of dimension, one...
Like going from R2 to R3.
Well, all right, here's the problem with that. If you go from, if you change dimension, like let's suppose we took all the points in this room, which form a three-dimensional space, and we just dropped them all to the floor to a two-dimensional space. Well, that's not one-to-one.
Right, okay.
So I've been thinking in general that we want things to be one-to-one.
You kind of have an inequality there, like the norm in three spaces is always greater than or equal to, I guess.
Say it again.
I'm just going to take a stab at that, that you know, the our dot product norm for is always going to be greater than or equal to whatever the norm would be. I'm just kind of taking a stab at there. That probably generalizes.
I still don't understand what you're saying. Start from the beginning of the sentence.
So if you do what you were saying and project from higher dimensional space down to lower dimensional space, there's going to be some sort of inequality that
It's many to one. In fact, it's infinitely many to one. If you go from three-dimensional space to two-dimensional space.
There's some information that still carries over.
Oh, yeah. It's just not one-to-one. You're entitled to candy, though. You want to?
No.
Okay. Let me now introduce something that Einstein introduced a very long time ago. Namely, he said, well, he got tired of writing these summation signs. And so he said, from now on, I'm going to let this be a sum on k, or rather a sum on I, of ai, bi. And notice that there's one lower index and one upper index. In fact, the lower indices we normally call covariant and the upper ones contravariant. So if you have an index repeated, one covariant, the other one contravariant, what we really mean is the sum over however many dimensions you've got. And okay, now let's look at a particular example of this. Suppose we have partial x prime I, partial xk, partial xk, partial x prime j. Well, here we have a covariant index, a contravariant index, repeated. So this really is the sum k equals 1 to n, partial x prime I, partial xk, partial x prime j. And now if we just use the chain rule, we see this is nothing more than partial x prime I, partial x prime j, and this is delta ij, which is to say 1 if I is j, 0 if I is not j. This thing that happens here, where you've got this repeated index and you sum over it, when you first look at it, you'd say this depends upon three indices. But in fact, it only depends upon two indices, and in this case, in a very simple way. But in general, this thing is called a contraction. In other words, one of the indices gets summed over, and because it's summed over, it becomes effectively a dummy index.
Where did the j come from? I guess, I don't know. It seems...
I just picked it as some other index.
Okay.
So there are three indices, I, j, and then k.
Okay.
And you're right, I should have used L.
No, it's fine. It seemed... After using two of the C's, it's fine. I got it.
Yeah.
So,
seems very optimistic.
Anyway, Minkowski space. So we're basically, we're leaving Euclidean space now. We're going into something a little more complicated, Minkowski space. And that would be four dimensions, time, and then three space dimensions. And what we're going to have is a new inner product. And the new inner product is going to be based on what's called the metric of flat space-time. And I never know whether I should write this as one word with a hyphen, or two words. And the trouble is that the only people who use space-time are physicists, and so we don't have enough usage to have a convention for this. Okay, what is this metric? Well, it's eta KL. And it's the same thing as eta upper KL, and it's equal to minus 1 if K equals L equals 0, 1 if K equals L equals 1, 2, or 3, and 0 if K is not equal to L. And this is the same thing in matrix form as minus 1, 1, 1, 1. So this is the thing that we had when we talked about the Lorentz group. So that's the metric of flat space time. And now, this thing defines an inner product. And in chapter 1 of my book, I talk about inner products. And most, the inner products that we use most often are the ones of, that are like the dot product. That is to say, they're positive, definite. It's too bad I didn't bring that. Let's see, the this inner product that we're talking about here would be say A plus A P plus well A Q plus B P Q R. Okay. So it would be A times P Q plus B times PR, and you can show that that implies also that AQ plus PR. This when we're talking about special and general relativity, in general, all the coordinates are real and all the vectors are real. You can talk about a complexified one, but I don't see any point in doing that. It's not standard generality. And if we did this, then we would have simply QP plus T RP. And in a normal inner product, the thing is positive or positive definite. But here, what we say is that if PF is zero for all F, then P is zero. So that's a different, this is called a non-degenerate indefinite inner product. So that's what the Minkowski inner product is. It's non-degenerate, meaning that if some vector is orthogonal to all the vectors in the space, then that vector has to be zero. It's non-degenerate, but it's indefinite. And it's indefinite because PP can be greater than zero, and PP can be less than zero, and PP can be equal to zero. And in fact, we're going to be calling these space-like. And these ones are time-like.
I thought I saw that reverse.
Well, no, I'm doing it this way. And these guys are null. What, here, you get a candy for bringing that up. Good catch. What we've got here is, notice that my minus sign is just on the time components.
Okay, CT squared.
Right, so it's space squared minus time squared. So it's like P squared minus E squared. It's,
okay.
In other words, there are two conventions. All right, let me just do this again. So in other words, here we have PQ. What is this going to be? We can call it P dot Q if we want, but the dot is not the dot of the Euclidean dot product. It's eta KL QL. And notice I'm using the Einstein summation convention. So we're summing on K and we're summing on L. And what this actually is then is, you can think of it as P vector dot Q vector minus P zero Q zero. And now, if one of the time component vanishes, then it's just the ordinary Euclidean dot product. And we can think then of some basis vectors, and now our basis vectors would be such that EI, EJ would be eta ij. So that's the way we have them. But that would mean that the inner product of E0 with itself is minus 1. So that's why the thing is said to be indefinite. Or equivalently here, PP can be less than 0 as well as positive. And we can choose. So the essential thing is EI dot EJ should be eta ij. If we want to choose a different set, well, I again said chose I and J by mistake. So if we choose a different set of basis vectors, we still want their inner product to be the same eta ij. And in fact, the relationship between the E's and the E primes is actually a Lorentz transformation. And so we might say that P, for example, is EI XI, or we could say that it's E prime I X prime I. And now we want some dual vectors, EI. And we can make these dual vectors rather simply, namely, out of the basis vectors EK, we multiply them by eta ik. And now, why is that a dual vector? Well, we want the inner product of ei with, say, el to be delta il, and this thing is then EK eta IK with EL, but EK with EL, this is eta IK, but this thing, in other words, EK EL, is eta KL. But this is just the matrix product of two etas. And you see that the matrix product of two things, that's minus 1, 1, 1, 1, times minus 1, 1, 1, 1, well, this is just 1, 1, 1, 1. And so this is just delta I L. And that's what we wanted. So that's how we make a dual vector. And for the ones that are primed, well, we would say that E prime I would be eta I L E prime L. Again, summed over L. This summation convention makes the notation much more compact. And it's a little bit like using matrix notation with, it almost makes the, allows you to use indices as easily as one uses matrices. When you multiply matrices, the indices, of course, are gone. I mean, unless you actually do the matrix multiplication. But the when you write the thing down symbolically, there are no indices. In the case of the summation convention, there are no sums, and it's almost like matrix multiplication. All right, so let's see. Any questions? All right. Maybe I'll flip the board to get more space. Somebody someday is going to flip this thing when it's too close to the blackboard. And this thing is going to gouge a terrible scratch in the blackboard. I've warned the future chairman about that, but so far nobody's done anything. All you need is for you to put, if you had big band-aids, you could just put the band-aids on all four corners.
You just like duct tape some bubble wrap to it.
Like what?
You can just duct tape some bubble wrap.
Duct tape, yeah, that's the solution to everything these days, duct tape. You're absolutely right. Okay, so let's see where we were here. So we decided that we would form the dual vectors that way. But now, suppose we have some dual vectors, Ej. What happens if we multiply that by, that's supposed to be an eta. Oh my gosh, this eta, now let's make this a k. Well, what I want to say is that this is EI. And why is that EI? Well, because this thing with, let us say, EL, well, this would be eta IK EK eta L R, say, E R. The dot product of this with that is delta K R eta I K eta L R. The R becomes a K, so this is eta IK, eta LK. This eta is obviously symmetric, so this is eta IK, eta KL, and this is just the product of two etas, and so this is delta LI. So in other words, eta really does lower an index, because these guys are doing the thing that they're supposed to do. Or equivalently, let's try this, EI, EL. This would be eta IK, EK, ER, say, eta LR, right? And, well, I have to say what the inner product of two dual vectors is. Well, the dual vectors, EK, ER, we know what these are. Namely, this is eta K, I say, EI, eta RL, EL. And so altogether, this is eta KI, eta RL, IL is eta IL, right. And so this one summed over L is giving me eta KI, this is delta RI. And so this one gives us eta kr. So this, the inner product of two dual vectors is eta kr, which of course is the same thing as eta kr. Okay, well, I guess we're out of time. Anyway, the point is that in special relativity, you could raise or lower indices with just this eta, and so this gets back to what I said to you a half hour ago, namely that the difference between covariant and contravariant, or between upper and lower indices in special relativity, is just a minus sign in the time components, which is to say you just multiply by eta. Okay. All right, well,